So what's his thing? What is it that we care about when we talk about Cicero? Well, the subject is freedom. That is one of the most constant themes that we have here in our 30 weeks. So he is the voice, probably the earliest, best voice for freedom. And in his life, he's a voice for heroism in the face of tyranny. Nobody better. There's no story greater of a heroic stance in the face of almost certain death in his last year of life. His choice to go back to Rome in the last year of his life and speak out publicly in the Senate against the growing tyranny of Mark Antony is essentially his death sentence, and he knows it. But he does it anyway, because he is literally the last man standing. That is, he's the last man from the old republic still articulating. So in terms of all the great heroes of freedom all through time who stand up to tyranny and maybe die, like Beckett, this man is sort of the beginning of it all, the great figure. And there are Greeks earlier who also stand up for freedom and die. Socrates is a good example. But I don't think there's any example better than Cicero's choice in the last year of his life, 43, to speak out. Now, everybody knew this in the next 2,000 years. Everybody knew this about him. Everybody knew this final story. Everybody knew it's Mark Antony, tyranny descending on Rome, and that Cicero speaks out. So that's why he's taken up again and again and again through hundreds and hundreds of years, because people knew what had happened. So if they were living in a moment of tyranny, if they're living in a moment of a test, up to and including World War II and the French resistance and other groups, they treasured Cicero, and they would dig it out and read it to each other, and they had copies of his letters, etc., because everybody knew that in the face of tyranny, this man had stood up. So he is a model for 2,000 years, and therefore, we should never forget him, and I don't think anybody will. I think people will remember him as long as there is freedom to be remembered. Now, number two, he is the Latin expert on rhetoric. That is, everyone agreed he was the greatest speech maker. He knew how to do a great Latin speech better than anybody else. He taught people how to do it. He wrote about it. And so again, in this field, how to speak publicly, he was the master. You have a great example there in the end of your collection of books, letters, the second Philippic, which means the title refers to Demosthenes in Greece, who delivers these great speeches against Alexander's father, Philip. And so they were called Philippics. They were speeches in Athens against the growing tyranny from the point of view of Athens that was being descended upon Greece by Philip. So that was the first, those were the first Philippics. Now Cicero comes back and he calls these the second Philippics. There's several of them, so it's a plural. And he's referring back to Demosthenes and Philip. So that's how it gets the title. And then the letters. Now this is a phenomenal breakthrough, an extraordinary and wonderful breakthrough, because Cicero invents the idea of a collection of letters being published. He invents it. He creates it. He thinks of it. He collects his letters. He hands them to his secretary, who edits them. They get other people's letters, that is, people who wrote to him and have his letters, and they bring them all together, and then they publish them. Now, of course, in the year 44 BC, publishing meant copiers copy it, and then people come to the little copy store and say, could you please get me a copy of Cicero's letters? And the copy store says, yes, that'll cost you X drachmas or whatever. Then people do that. So yes, he invents the idea of a collection of letters. And if you think in your mind of some of your favorite published collection of letters, think it all starts with Cicero. And once printing is invented in 1450-60, then from then on, people are going to print a collection of letters to so-and-so back and forth all through the 1600s, 1700s, 1800s, all of the 18th century Enlightenment people published letters, Voltaire published letters. Everybody did. So it became a big, big popular type of literature, letters. And if you think in your own mind of, you know, great, great exchanges of letters that you've read in your life, Van Gogh with his brother, Theo, to me, that's the greatest. But there's so many. Hemingway's letters are spectacular. If you've never read them, there's a wonderful edition, Hemingway's letters. They're just fantastic because they're all to the greatest writers in the whole world at the time. So he invents it. And then the 2,000 years of influence. People read these books, read the books in Latin, and so his influence continued on and on and on and on. So, quick look back, foundation of Rome, roughly 753 BC. This was always a mythical date. Now we're finding out it really is a correct date. It is that far back. What about the rise of Rome? Well, we already said, unique location on a river network in all of central Italy. Great location to be linked up to Greeks. Great location to be linked up to the Etruscans. And a location for the Carthaginians. So all these influences are with them. Here's the island in the middle of the city. And Rome extends Greece. Rome extends Christianity. Rome becomes the center of Christianity, not Jerusalem. You'd think it'd be Jerusalem, but it's not. It'll be Rome. Rome creates the idea of the ecumene, the universal state, provides a model of government for us, the Republic, three parts of government. It has the first written constitution in all of history, 450, and gives Western civilization all of its legal structure. It builds the roads, it builds the cities, it builds the bridges. So it really creates the great unity that is Europe, and essentially it creates Europe. Before Rome, there is no Europe. There's just parts here and there. But the Roman Empire brings all of them together.